So let me start today's discussion on this particular chapter, that is on the introductory discussion on the MOS devices. So in the last class, we have developed the expression for the current, the drain to source current. Let me once again remind you the three different terminals of any MOSFET. So as you know, there are three different terminals like gate, drain and source. And apart from that, there is another terminal which is known as the fourth terminal and which is known as the body or substrate or bulk. So in fact, there are four terminals: gate, drain, source and body. But today, initially, I will start my discussion considering these three terminals only, gate, drain and source. And ultimately, I will show you what are the implications of the potential at the base terminal or this substrate terminal. So last year, we have already found out the expression for the drain to source current, which was like this. Mu n C aux W by L. Then you have this VGS minus VTH. Into VDS minus half VDS square. So that was the expression of drain to source current, where mu n is nothing but the mobility of the electron. C aux is the oxide capacitance. W and L are nothing but the width and the length of the channel. VGS is nothing but the gate to source voltage, as you can understand. VTH is the threshold voltage, which is the minimum value of VGS to make the device on. And VDS is the drain to source voltage. So that expression was derived last day, which shows that ID is essentially a function of the different terminal voltages like VGS, VDS. And apart from that, it is also a function of the device dimension, that means W and L. And in fact, this W by L, this is known as the aspect ratio. W by L is known as the aspect ratio. And last day I have mentioned that the drain current is dependent upon W by L ratio. So here in MOS technology, the system designer is concerned about W by L only. And there are certain technology parameters like mu n and C aux. Now, if I would like to draw the corresponding variation of ID with respect to VDS, then let us see how does it look like. ID versus VDS.
This equation is valid for only active linear region. Though.
Sorry, I can't get you.
The equation of ID is valid for only linear region. This equation, which is written on.
Can you please write down your question in the chat box so that I can follow it up?
Okay.
Let me draw the curve and then accordingly I will take up your question. So the terminal current is the drain current or drain to source current. And the voltage is the drain to source voltage. So let me just draw it. So as you can understand, this ID versus VDS, so XY graph here, this Y can be represented as some constant into X minus some constant into X square. So essentially, this particular equation, ID is equal to mu n C aux W by L into VGS minus VTH into VDS minus half VDS square. It will be nothing but a parabola to start with. So let me draw the parabola for different values of VGS minus VTH. So intentionally I would like to draw by means of a dotted line. Upendra Kumar has asked that this equation is valid only for linear region. Okay, so far I have not mentioned anything about the linear region. So let me first mention what is meant by the linear region. By the time I complete my discussion, I think you'll be able to get the answer. So let me draw it for different values of VGS minus VTH. So for example, let us consider three different values for VGS. Assuming that the VTH is constant or the threshold voltage is constant. So let me draw for VGS1, VGS2, and VGS3. So from the equation itself, it is quite apparent that ID varies with VDS, and that variation will be nothing but a square law variation. So it will look something like that, and there will be a peak. So you can easily find out the peak. So to find out the peak, what you need to do is that you have to differentiate this ID with respect to VDS, because this graph is for ID versus VDS. So in order to find out the peak, so you need to find out the corresponding derivative, dy dx, that is del ID by del VDS. And you need to equate this result to zero. And what is del ID by del VDS? So as you can see, this is mu n C aux W by L. And then we have VGS minus VTH. And then we have VDS only. So I need to make this particular thing equal to zero when ID is equal to ID max. So when ID is equal to ID max, when ID attains its peak value or maximum value, then the derivative of ID with respect to VDS should be zero. So that should be zero for ID is equal to ID max. And from that, you can easily find out that the corresponding value of VDS is given by VGS minus VTH. So this particular graph has been drawn for three different values of VGS. So suppose this one is for a particular VGS. Let this be VGS 1 minus VTH. Let this be for another VGS. This is VGS2 minus VTH, and you can clearly understand that VGS1 is less than VGS2, and this one is for the third VGS, which is nothing but VGS3 minus VTH. It is quite apparent that, let me write over here, that VGS1 is less than VGS2 and which is less than VGS3. So as long as the value of VDS is less than VGS minus VTH, the current will increase following this parabola, just like this. Now let us consider that these are the three different peaks, and the peaks are dependent upon the value of the gate to source voltage, and the peak is obtained whenever the drain to source voltage is equal to gate to source voltage minus the threshold voltage. Now under this condition, we can have a different regions of operations, as Upendra has already asked. Now let us try to clarify that particular point. Let me once again write down the expression for ID, the overall expression for ID, which is equal to mu n C ox W by L into VGS minus VTH into VDS minus half VDS square. Now essentially, if I just blindly follow that particular equation, so it may seem that ID varies with VDS square. That means it will follow a parabola. Now let us impose some condition. The condition is that let us assume that VGS minus VTH into VDS is greater than half VDS square. That means this term is greater than the second term. From that, one can write VGS minus VTH. Or 2 times of VGS minus VTH is greater than VDS. That means as long as VDS is less than 2 times VGS minus VTH, then I can approximate this equation of ID. I can approximate this ID to mu n C ox W by L into VGS minus VTH into VDS only. When the condition is VDS is much, much less as compared to 2 times VGS minus VTH. Now, if this condition gets satisfied, that VGS minus VTH or 2 times of that is much, much higher as compared to the drain to source voltage, then I can safely neglect the second term, the square term over here. Now, what we find is ID is equal to mu n C ox W by L VGS minus VTH into VDS. Now, if I once again go back to the previous graph, now this condition is satisfied over here. That means the value of drain to source voltage is much, much smaller as compared to the overdrive voltage. This VGS minus VTH, we fondly call this particular term VGS minus VTH as overdrive voltage. This is known as overdrive voltage.
Sir, is there any significance of this word overdrive?
Yes. As you know, in order to operate any MOS device, the corresponding value of gate to source voltage should be higher than the threshold voltage. So far I am assuming that the gate to source voltage has to be greater than threshold voltage so that the channel is created and the device starts operating. In fact, if I consider some second order effect of MOS devices, then you will see that there is a notion called the subthreshold conduction, where even for the gate to source voltage less than the threshold voltage, the device will be on and some amount of current will flow. But right now I am not considering that fact. I'm considering that the gate to source voltage should be greater than the threshold voltage so that the device becomes on. So what about the effective voltage available to create the inversion layer charge? The effective voltage is nothing but VGS minus VTH. So that's why it is known as overdrive voltage, because this is the effective voltage which is available to the device so that the inversion layer charge is produced and the channel is created. Now, whenever this overdrive voltage or twice the overdrive voltage is much, much larger as compared to the drain to source voltage, or in other words, if I say that the magnitude of the drain to source voltage is very small as compared to this overdrive voltage, that means you are very much close to the origin of this graph over here only, when the VDS value is very small, because this x-axis is VDS and y-axis is ID. So whenever you are over here, that means VDS is very small, then I can approximate this ID versus VDS graph as a straight line. Because if I just once again come back over here, you will see that ID is given by some constant multiplied with VDS. Mu n COX WIL, so for a particular MOS technology and for a particular device dimension, you can consider that this mu n COX WIL, everything is constant. And as long as I am considering a fixed value of gate to source voltage, let it be say VGS 2 minus VTH. So this part is also constant, this VGS minus VTH, that is also constant. So therefore, this entire thing, mu n COX WIL VGS minus VTH, can be treated as a constant. And ID varies linearly with VDS. ID is some constant multiplied with VDS. Now, this condition is true whenever VDS is much, much less as compared to the twice of VGS minus VTH. So therefore, when this condition is true, then the MOS device basically acts like a resistor. It acts like a resistor because the current and voltage relationship follows the linearity property. ID is equal to some constant multiplied with the VDS. And we mentioned that particular region of operation as the triode region or linear region. So as Upendra was asking that whether this is true for a linear region or not. Now this is only true whenever this particular condition holds good. When VDS is much, much smaller as compared to twice of VGS minus VTH, then the linear relationship can be established. And under this condition, one can easily find out the value of the resistance. As I am talking about the resistance, so in linear region or triode or linear region, we can easily find out the expression for the resistance. So RD is given by VDS upon ID, and which is given by 1 upon mu n COX WIL into VGS minus VTH.
Sir, why is it triode region?
Okay, I'm coming to that. So if I just consider that particular expression, this mu n COX WIL into VGS minus VTH, you can see that this mu n COX WIL is constant, that is fine. But the resistance depends upon the value of RD, depends upon VGS minus VTH. So even if VTH is constant, that means the threshold voltage is constant, you'll find that the drain to source resistance can be regarded as a variable resistance, and the value depends upon the gate to source voltage. So it varies with VGS or gate to source voltage. So if I have a MOS device like this, let me consider the MOS device in this fashion. Suppose this is the drain terminal, this is the source terminal, and we have gate over here. Then under this condition, when the drain to source voltage is much, much small as compared to the gate to source minus the threshold voltage, then that can be regarded as a simple resistance. So MOS can be used as a simple resistance connected between the drain to source, and whose value is controlled by the gate to source voltage, and which is the property of the transistor. That means transistor means transfer resistor. So the resistance value between the two terminals, the source and drain, is being controlled by some third terminal, and this third terminal is known as the gate terminal. So depending upon the gate to source voltage VGS that you are applying over here, the drain to source resistance or the resistance of the device can be modeled accordingly. Now this condition is only true as long as the device operates in the linear region. So in the linear region, I can safely neglect the second term. So if I once again come back over here, so in the linear region, I can safely neglect this second term, this half of VDS square, and it will be simply mu n COX WIL VGS minus VTH into VDS. And the maximum value of current is obtained whenever the VDS value or the drain to source voltage is equal to VGS minus VTH. Now, what happens beyond this particular point? Will it follow this parabola beyond this VGS minus VTH? That means whenever the drain to source voltage goes higher than VGS minus VTH, will it follow this particular graph or not? So in order to understand this particular question, once again, let me consider the architecture, I mean the cross section of a MOS device. Then you can understand the notion of the pinch off. Already in the last class, we have discussed about what is meant by the pinch off. Now, as you know, let me discuss the operation pertaining to an NMOS. So as you know, it is constructed on a P substrate, and there are two different N plus regions, which are known as the source and the drain respectively. And over this, we do have one insulator, silicon dioxide insulator, and from that, we have polysilicon layer, and the gate terminal is connected like this. And accordingly, these two terminals are known as the source and the drain respectively. So suppose this one is the drain terminal and this one is the source terminal. Now, so far I have neglected the effect of the body or the bulk. Now, in order to ensure that the channel is created between these two N plus regions, between the source and the drain, we have to ensure that the corresponding amount of charge must be present over here so that the channel might be created. Now, in order to ensure this condition, the VG minus VT, that value, that means that if I consider the gate potential, so here I'm assuming that the source is grounded. So source potential equal to zero. So gate potential, absolute value of the gate potential and the absolute value of the drain potential, so their difference, VG minus VT, it should be greater than the threshold voltage at any point along the channel. So as you are moving from this point to this point, so this corresponds to, so this is the source end, this is the source end, and this is the drain end. So this corresponds to x equal to zero, and this corresponds to x equal to L. If the length of the channel is L, so it starts from the source and ends at drain. So this point corresponds to x is equal to zero, and this point corresponds to x equal to L. So as you move from this point to this point, that means from x equal to zero to x equal to L, from source to drain, the value of VG minus VT is no longer constant. You have to ensure that this value should be always higher than the threshold voltage so that the corresponding charge is being present within the channel. So if I consider that the drain to source voltage, let us assume that drain to source voltage VDS is just greater than VGS minus VTH, just higher than VGS minus VTH, then what will happen? So in fact, in the last class, we have already formulated the effective voltage that is present. So in fact, that voltage was written like, if we can remember, that voltage was, sorry, it will be VGS. So the effective voltage, which is responsible for the inversion of the channel, is given by VGS minus VX minus VTH. Because of this voltage, we do have enough amount of charge carriers. So in this particular case, electrons will be the charge carriers, and the corresponding QD value, the depletion region charge, is proportional to this particular voltage. This QD is proportional to this particular voltage, VGS minus VX minus VTH. Now, whenever you are at x equal to L, when you are at x equal to L, that means VX equal to VDS, drain to source voltage, you are at this particular point. And if the condition is VDS is greater than VGS minus VTH, that means that value VGS minus VX minus VTH will be less than zero. So the channel will be pinched off at the drain end. On the other hand, if you go on increasing the value of VDS beyond this value, VGS minus VTH, then the channel will be pinched off before the drain terminal. So suppose here the channel is pinched off over here. So here the channel pinched off over here when VDS is let me consider this is equal to VGS minus, or let it be greater than VGS minus VTH. And if I consider another such structure on an NMOS device, and if I go on increasing the value of drain to source voltage, assuming that the effective length being the same, so this is the insulator, and we have the gate terminal over here. So this is the drain terminal. The source is grounded as before. Now here, if I increase the value of VDS, now here it is suppose VDS 1, and here it is say, let it be say VDS 2, and which is higher than VDS 1, then what happens? The channel will be pinched off before the drain terminal. So over here, for example, suppose this value equal to X equal to X2. And this value, suppose X equal to X1. In fact, X1 equal to L. What does it mean? V of X1 is equal to exactly equal to VGS minus VTH. And V of X2 is equal to VGS minus VTH. So as you go on increasing the drain to source voltage, what happens? The pinch off point will move towards the source end. So as a matter of fact, the corresponding amount of current will no longer be following that particular shape. So once again, I have to derive the expression of the drain to source current following this particular assumption. So if you can remember, the expression of current was something like that. The ID was like mu n C aux VGS minus VX minus VTH into, we have W over here, mu n C aux and W. So let me just erase that part. Let me once again write down the expression. It was like C aux into W. I'm considering from the pretty fundamental equation, VGS minus VTH minus VX into mu n dVx by dx. So this is the fundamental equation which we have considered in the last day. So as you can understand, or as you can remember, this is nothing but QD, the charge in the depletion region, QD multiplied with the V, that is the velocity. So QD is proportional to the voltage available for the for inverting the channel, that is VGS minus VTH minus VX. And we have C aux into W, that part, because C aux is measured per unit area. This is oxide capacitance per unit area. So in order to find out the charge density per unit length, you need to multiply the oxide capacitance per unit area with the width of the channel. So that's why C aux into W will give you the oxide capacitance per unit length when it is multiplied with the available voltage, which is responsible for generating the channel or creating this inversion. So this will give you the total depletion region charge per unit length, and this is multiplied with the velocity. And velocity, as you know, V is equal to mu into E, and accordingly E is equal to minus dvdx. So that formula we have discussed in the last place, so I'm not going into that, but this is the fundamental formula from where I have to once again rederive the expression for ID. So from that, we know that ID into dx This is equal to mu n Cox W into VGS minus VTH minus VX. Now, last time while deriving the expression for ID, we have considered that at x equal to 0, VX was 0, and at x equal to L, VX was equal to VTS. So that was the previous condition which we have used in the last day. But this time, whenever the value of the drain to source voltage is larger than VGS minus VTH, as you understand, the channel will be pinched off earlier. So therefore, now at x equal to 0, VX equal to 0, okay, let me write side by side. At x equal to 0, when x equal to 0, that means whenever you are at the source end, at x equal to 0, Vx equal to 0, that is fine. And when x equal to L dashed, which is known to be the effective channel length, then Vx equal to VGS minus VTH. Because when that local voltage is equal to VGS minus VTH, then the channel will be pinched off. So this is the modification. When x equal to L dashed, Vx will become VGS minus VTH. Now with this modification, let me once again find out the expression for the current. So here x will vary from 0 to L dashed dx, and that is given by mu n Cox W, so which are constant. And here Vx equal to 0 to Vx equal to VGS minus VTH. Oh, I missed this DVX part. So VGS minus VTH minus Vx DVX. So this will give you ID into L dashed, that is equal to mu n Cox W. Now VGS minus VTH DVX will give you VGS minus VTH into VX, and the limit is from 0 to VGS minus VTH. So therefore, the first term will be VGS minus VTH whole square, and the second term is VX DVX. So X DX will give you X square upon 2, and the highest limit is VGS minus VT, so it will be half of X square. That means half of VGS minus VTH whole square. So therefore, I can write ID is equal to mu n Cox W by L to VGS minus VTH whole square, the half outside. So that is the expression of current whenever you are considering the notion of pinch off. So pinch off occurs when the value of VDS, or drain to source voltage, is just higher than VGS minus VTH. So this is the point of pinch off, and the current gets saturated at that particular point. If you calculate the value of current at VGS minus VTH, so already we have established that the current will be maximum when del ID by del VDS equal to 0, and it will be maximum when VDS equal to VGS minus VTH. If I put this value over here, VDS equal to VGS minus VTH, you will find that the maximum current is ID max. ID max is given by, if I put the value of VDS equal to VGS minus VTH, then you'll see that by putting the value, it will be nothing but half mu n Cox W by L into VGS minus VTH whole square, this current. And it will be different for different VGS. And once the pinch off occurs, the current will become constant. So ideally, I can assume that the current will become constant, but whenever we will study the different second order effects of most devices, and this is essentially true whenever we consider short channel devices. So there you'll see that the current is no longer constant. But anyway, as long as we are not considering the second order effect, so the current will become constant, and it will be something like that beyond this point. So parallel to this BDS axis. Because if you just follow the expression of ID, you will see that it is no longer dependent upon VDS beyond this point. And this region where the current is constant, this region is known as the saturation region. So in fact, there are two different regions. One region is known as the linear region, unlike your BJT. So in case of BJT, you do have like, if I want to segregate in terms of the linear and saturation, you'll see that for BJT, whenever the IB and IC, this base current and the collector current, when they vary proportionately, that particular region is known as the linear region. Now here you'll see that, and we operate the BJT in the linear region so as to use it as an amplifier. But here, that particular region, the saturation region, is the region where I'll be using the device as an amplifier. Now why? Saturation region is used to model the device as an amplifier, model this MOS as an amplifier. So I'm coming to that. And to give the answer to this question, I have to find out another important parameter pertaining to this. Now, if I just once again consider this saturation region where the current gets saturated, so even if you increase the value of VDS, the drain to source voltage, you'll see that the drain current remaining constant, the drain to source current remaining constant, and this region is known as the saturation region. And here you'll see that we are changing the value of VDS, but ID is remaining constant. So essentially, ID, the value of ID depends upon the value of the gate to source voltage. So if I once again consider the MOS architecture, depending upon the value of the gate to source voltage, the corresponding drain to source current gets modified. So we should devise one particular figure of merit, which can tell us how sensitive the device is in converting the gate to source voltage into a drain to source current. So here we are providing the input as the gate to source voltage. And already I have mentioned in the last class that this MOSFET, as the name suggests, it's a field effect transistor. That means it is controlled by the corresponding field. That means it is a voltage control device, unlike your BJT, which is essentially current control device. So the voltage over here, the input voltage over here is the gate to source voltage. And accordingly, the current gets modulated. Current is changing. So how does the device perform this operation? So that can be understood from a performance parameter, and that performance parameter is known as the mutual conductance or transconductance, or GM, as you have also seen this GM in case of BJT. Now here GM will give you the variation of ID with respect to the gate to source voltage. So mutual conductance or transconductance. So already, first of all, let me write down the expression for ID. So ID in the saturation region is given by half of mu n C ox W by L into VGS minus VTH whole square. So that is the expression for ID in the saturation region. And this is the peak value of the current. So from that, one can easily find out the GM value. So from that expression, if you find out the derivative with respect to GS, then you will find that it will be nothing but mu n C ox W by L into VGS minus VTH. So from that, you can also find out another interesting feature, that this GM, which is calculated in the saturation region, is nothing but the inverse of the resistance which we have calculated in the linear region. So if you just consider that particular resistance value, you'll see that this resistance value and this RD was calculated in the linear region. So this calculation was done in the linear region, a trial region. That is, RD is equal to 1 upon mu n C ox W by L into VGS minus VTH. And the same value of GM you have got over here. I mean, 1 upon RD, mu n C ox W by L into VGS minus VTH. So this is equal to, I can write, this GM is equal to 1 upon RD in the linear region. Now, what I find is the value of GM depends upon the gate to source voltage. And this GM is calculated in the saturation region. Now, what happens in the linear region? Now, to answer this question, let us consider a simple circuit involving a MOS, NMOS device. Suppose this is a drain terminal and the source is grounded. And let this potential equal to say, let it be say VB, for example. And this potential is say, let it be say VDD. Now let us try to find out the value of GM, the mutual conductance, for this, for a very high value of VDD. So I would like to plot GM for a very high value of VDD. So I am changing the value of VDD. So this is a variable voltage. It is not constant. So as you can understand, if I consider a very high value of this particular voltage VDD, obviously this is a drain voltage. Source is already grounded. So essentially this voltage is a drain to source voltage. And if this drain to source voltage is very large, obviously the device will be in the saturation region, because already you have seen that if the drain to source voltage is greater than the gate to source minus the threshold voltage, then the device enters into the saturation region. So for very high value of VDD, if I go on reducing the value of VDD from ideally say from infinity, then the device starts operating from the saturation region. And what about the corresponding transconductance or mutual conductance? So this is given by mu n C ox W by L into VGS minus VTH. So therefore, it will be essentially a constant term, unless the device enters into the linear region. So if I move from infinity, so it will be constant throughout. And now this is the point where the value of VDD or VDS, in fact, this is the drain to source voltage, when this value is equal to the gate to source voltage minus the threshold voltage, and this is the beginning of the linear region. Now, in the linear region, once again, if I calculate the value of GM, you will find that in the linear region, the expression was as simple as we have another minus half VDS square over here. No other value. And you will see that, okay, let me write it down so that you can understand. Let me write down the overall expression, the total expression. So ID was mu n C ox W upon L VGS minus VTH into VDS minus half VDS square. So that was the expression I can consider. So if I calculate del ID by del VGS, del ID by del VGS, here you'll see that this mu n C ox W by L will be there. And apart from that, there will be some VDS. So the expression for GM in the linear region will be given by mu n C ox W by L into VDS. So in the linear region, GM is linearly related to the drain to source voltage. Let us try to understand this point. In the saturation region, GM is constant. In saturation region, GM is constant. GM constant. And in the linear region, GM decreases with increasing VDS. With reducing VDS, sorry, because it is directly proportional to VDS. So GM decreases with VDS. So as the drain to source voltage drops, GM also drops. So I can write down the expression for GM. So this is given by mu n C ox W by L into VDS only. So it is directly proportional to VDS. So therefore, whenever the device enters into the linear region, then ultimately the mutual conductance drops, and when VDS equal to zero, then ultimately it drops down to zero. Something like that. So this is the variation of the mutual conductance with respect to the drain to source voltage. Now, what does this mutual conductance do? It will convert the gate to source voltage into a corresponding drain current. And whenever this drain current is passed through a resistance, then ultimately some voltage will be developed, and that will be the output voltage. Now, this parameter plays an important role in converting the input voltage to an output current. So obviously, in order to maximize the output for a given input, and that is the job of an amplifier, to maximize the output for a given input, if the input is like, say, 1 millivolt, our output should be like, say, 1 volt, in order to have a gain of 1,000. So therefore, if the value of GM is large, then you can understand that for a given value of VGS, the corresponding value of ID is more. And in fact, for BJT also, you have seen that the expression for the voltage gain for a simple common emitter amplifier with unbypassed resistance, it was like GM times RC, minus GM times RC. So in fact, the gain value was directly proportional to GM or the mutual conductance. So always we will try to maximize the value of GM so that the overall gain expression is maximum. So if I once again look at this particular variation, here you will see that the GM will be maximum only in the, so this is the saturation region. So GM will be maximum only in the saturation region. So this is the saturation region where GM is maximum. And it will be small in the linear region. And ultimately, when the VDD is very small, it will be almost close to zero. Therefore, we will always prefer a value of GM which is large, and that is available only in the saturation region for a MOSFET. Therefore, to use the MOSFET, NMOS or PMOS as an amplifier, we will always operate the device in the saturation region. So that is the important observation from that particular expression, that in order to use the MOS as an amplifier, so MOS as an amplifier, unlike the BJT, in case of BJT, you have seen that in order to use the BJT as an amplifier, you have to bias the BJT in the linear region or active region. But here, in order to operate the device, the MOS device as an amplifier, you have to operate in the saturation region. So MOS as an amplifier means the saturation region. However, what is the advantage of this linear region over here? We have already seen that in the linear region, I can always identify the MOS as a resistor. So here, in case of VLSI devices or VLSI technology, we don't require any additional resistance, additional capacitance, additional inductance. And that makes the entire circuit much more compact, because all the elements like resistance, apart from the amplification, so amplifier is itself the device itself, that is MOS. And apart from that, if I consider the resistance, which are required for the biasing, if I consider capacitance, so everything can be modeled by means of the MOS. And in fact, you have seen that in the saturation region, the corresponding drain to source current is constant. In the saturation region, if I consider that particular graph once again, ignoring the effect of the second order effect. So here, in the saturation region, the drain to source current is constant. So since the drain to source current is constant, so in the saturation region, I can always model the device as a current source. So already have seen that in the linear region, I can regard this as an resistance. I think I have already shown this one. Yeah, over here in the linear region. So this was done in the linear region. So in the linear region, I can model the device, this MOS device, as a resistance, just like this, a variable resistance, which is a function of the gate to source voltage. And similarly, in the saturation region, I can model the device, the MOS device, as a current source. For example, if the device, like, let me consider NMOS. and if this value is VDD, and if it is in the saturation region, then that can be, and if the corresponding current that is flowing over here is ID, and which is constant. So in fact, this is equivalent to an ideal current. So in fact, if I consider the second order effect, the current will not be constant. It will increase with VDS. So that is a separate issue. But as far as our understanding goes so far, if I just neglect the second order effect, then the device, MOS device, operated in the saturation region. So this is in the saturation region. So you have to ensure that this VDD must be greater than, so let it be VB, VB minus VTH. That means you are in the saturation region. Then it can be modeled as a current source. And in the linear region, I can model the MOS device as a resistor, the variable resistor. So that is the bottom line from that particular discussion, that to use the MOS as an amplifier, you have to operate it in the saturation region. Once again, since GM is a very important parameter as far as the property of the MOS device is concerned, so let me once again write down the expression for GM. The GM was given by mu n C aux W by L into VGS minus VTH. And the current expression was like ID is equal to half in the saturation region, half mu n C aux W by L into VGS minus VTH whole square. So from that, you can have a different expression for GM. For example, if I would like to represent GM in terms of, say, ID only, suppose I would like to substitute the value of mu n C aux W by L. So what I can do is, so mu n C aux W by L from this equation is given by 2ID upon VGS minus VTH whole square into you have VGS minus VTH. So therefore, a GM can be written as 2ID divided by VGS minus VTH. So this particular equation represents GM as a function of ID and VGS minus VTH. Similarly, if you'd like to keep VGS minus VTH, if I want to substitute the value of VGS minus VTH over here, then another expression for GM can be obtained. So these are the different representation. So over here, I can find VGS minus VTH to be equal to twice ID by mu n C aux W by L. So you have twice ID, and VGS minus VTH is nothing but two into two ID by mu n C aux W by L, and one upon that. So root over mu n C aux W by L upon 2ID. So here I can represent this as two ID mu n C aux W by L. So there are different representations for GM. So let me once again summarize these three different representations. Hopefully it will be better if I go into the next slide. So the first expression was like mu n C aux W by L into VGS minus VTH. Similarly, if I would like to represent GM as a function of ID, then this can be done by root over of twice id into mu n cox w by l. Or ultimately, you can also represent this as 2id upon VGS minus VTH. And accordingly, one can have the different variation of GM with respect to the dependent parameter. For example, if I consider that VGS minus VTH, that means overdrive voltage is the parameter. With respect to that, I would like to find out the variation of GM. Then from this equation, equation number one, so let it be equation number one, equation number two, and equation number three. So here, this GM varies linearly with VGS minus VT, so it will be something like that. If I consider the second equation, where GM varies, and here you have to consider that W by L is constant. I'm assuming that mu n cox is a device parameter, it is constant. I mean, the technology parameter, it is constant. And W by L, the aspect ratio, is constant. If it is constant, then only you can have this kind of variation. Now, if I would like to represent the variation of GM with respect to ID, so it's a root over of ID. GM is proportional to root ID with some constant outside. So it will be something like that. Once again, I am assuming that W by L is a constant. And for the third expression, if I assume that current is constant, so it will be like this. And ID is constant. So we can have different representation of the same variable, that is GM. And GM plays a very vital role in case of these analog MOS devices. And you have also seen the effect of GM for BJT in the electronic circuits. Now, having considered this, the different regions of operations, now let us try to identify. Now, what could have been the possible degradation as far as the performance of any MOS device is concerned? And this degradation is known as the different second order effects, as identified in the MOS device technology. Now, there are different second order effects, and which we have not considered so far, and we have to identify those second order effects accordingly. So first of all, although we have mentioned so far that MOS is having three terminals only, gate, drain, and source, but in fact there are another terminal, the fourth terminal, which is known as the substrate or body or bulk. So let me once again show it symbolically. So for an NMOS device, so this is known to be the source terminal, this is the drain terminal. And apart from that, we have a gate terminal over here. And the fourth terminal is the body or bulk, and which is represented by the term B. Now, so far, we have not paid any attention against this particular terminal, the body terminal, the bulk terminal. But what happens, you have to identify that, let me just draw the structure. The cross-sectional view of a MOS. And what happens if the body and the source, they are not tied together? So far, we have just neglected the effect of this body. So let us assume that we have P-type substrate and N plus regions at the source and the drain, and the gate over here. So this is the gate terminal. We have a drain over here. And we have a source over here. and the body. This is the fourth terminal, and sometimes it is also known as the second gate or back gate. Body or bulk. So we have p-type substrate over here, and the connection is done through a p-plus type of regions. Now, as you know, we have two different p-n junctions, n plus p and n plus p, formed at the source and the drain terminals, and these two p-n junctions are reverse biased. So that's why the corresponding potential for any n-most devices, this drain potential is considered to be positive, and for p-mos devices, the corresponding source potential will be positive. So these two n plus regions, I mean np regions, p-n junctions, so they are reverse biased. Now what happens if the corresponding body potential or the bulk potential is not equal to the ground potential? So here I'm assuming that suppose the source is at ground, and suppose the drain is also at ground. So Vs and Vd, both of them are at the ground potential. Now under this condition, if the potential at the bulk is less than zero, if it is negative, because I have to make this p-n junction reverse biased. So since it's a p-type, so if the Vb is less than zero, then the p-n junction will be in the reverse biased condition. Now, under this condition, we can think that there will be two different depletion regions, and the gate potentials should be higher than the threshold voltage so that the device will ultimately become turned on. But whether we need to identify by making the bulk potential less than zero, whether the threshold voltage of the MOS device is affected or not. Now, to answer this question, you have to find out what is the reason of having the threshold voltage for any MOS device. In fact, even if the source and the drain potentials are zero, that means even if Vs equal to Vd equal to zero, and if you put Vb is equal to zero, which we have considered so far, that means source and the body, they are connected together. Now, under this condition, the gate potential should be higher than a threshold voltage. Initially, there was no such channel created. Now, as you provide a positive voltage at the gate terminal, what happens? So in the p-type semiconductor, you have lots of holes as the majority carriers, and the holes will be repelled back beneath the oxide layer. Inside the channel, they will be repelled back, and we do have only the negatively charged ions. And whenever the corresponding value of Vg is large enough, or gate to source voltage is large enough, so that the local charge density is capable of producing a channel between the source and the drain, then the channel will be created, and we can say that the device will become on. Now, that was the scenario when the base potential, the bulk potential or the body potential is equal to zero. Now, what happens if, apart from providing a positive gate voltage, if I provide a negative substrate potential, that means if Vb is less than zero, then what happens? The corresponding value of the charge density, which is present over here, because of the holes moving towards the substrate region, that charge density will be much more, and the gate potential should be large enough to mirror that charge beneath the oxide layer, between the source and the drain. And therefore, if I provide a base potential, I mean the bulk potential Vb less than zero, in which case the Vsb is not equal to zero. Rather, Vsb is positive. Vsb means the difference between the source potential and the bulk potential. So if source and bulk, they are connected together, then Vsb will become zero. But when Vb is less than zero, then the value of Vsb is greater than zero. Now, when Vsb is greater than zero, under this condition, more amount of holes will be attracted towards this bulk terminal. And as a matter of fact, the depletion region charge density will be more, and to mirror that charge, the corresponding value of the gate voltage should be large enough. So therefore, when VSB is greater than zero, the threshold voltage of the device is larger as compared to when VSB equal to zero. And this threshold voltage, the expression for the threshold voltage can be represented as like threshold voltage under this condition is given by threshold voltage when the source and the body, they are connected together. That is the VTH zero. And there is some constant gamma. And the expression is given by twice pi a plus VSB mod of that, because for PMOS devices it could have been negative as well, minus 2 of pi f mod of that. But pi f is the surface, twice of pi f is the surface potential. Now as long as VSB equal to zero, that means source and the body, if they are connected together, then obviously this term inside the bracket will become zero, gamma times zero. So VTH will be equal to VTH zero. So there will be no change in the threshold voltage. But whenever we do have a positive VSB, that means the source to bulk potential is higher than zero. Under this condition only, you will find that this entire thing inside the bracket will give you some positive quantity. And when this is multiplied with a gamma, and the value of gamma is normally in the order of 0.2 to 0.3. So obviously when it is multiplied with some positive quantity, the value of VTH will be slightly higher than VTH zero. Now ultimately the effect is the threshold voltage will be large as compared to the threshold voltage when the body and the source, they are connected together. And this particular condition is known as body effect or backgate effect. So because of the body effect or backgate effect, and because of this particular, because this body terminal or the bulk terminal is sometimes known as the fourth terminal or the second gate terminal, because sometimes it is having some role in controlling the threshold voltage of the device. So it serves the purpose of a gate. So that's why it is known as a back gate or second gate. So back gate effect or body effect. So if you don't want that the body effect is prevalent in your structure, then the thing that you need to do is that the source and the bulk, or source and the substrate, they are connected together. Because in this particular equation, as you can find, if VSB equal to zero, the VSB, that means the source and body, the corresponding voltage difference, if this is equal to zero, then obviously the VTH will be equal to VTH zero. Otherwise, VTH will be greater than VTH zero, and the corresponding value of the threshold voltage will be large. So this is known as the body effect or the backgate effect. Now let us consider the another effect, and which results because of the pinch off condition. Now, so far we have seen that under pinch off condition, the expression of current ID was given by half mu n C ox W by L dashed into VGS minus VTH whole square. So this is the expression for the current under saturation region. And the saturation region occurs whenever you have the drain to source voltage greater than the gate to source minus the threshold voltage. And this is the beginning. When VDS is greater than VGS minus VTH, that means the device enters into the saturation region. So this is the condition for the saturation region. When VDS, the drain to source voltage, is higher than gate to source minus the threshold voltage, then the device enters into the saturation region and the current is remaining constant. Now we have already derived this expression today, and it was like half mu n C ox W by L dashed into VGS minus VTH whole square. Now when L dashed, or L is much, much larger, so under this condition, L dashed and L can be approximated. That means L dashed can be treated close to L. L dashed can be treated close to L when L is very large. However, when L is small, then we cannot equate L dashed equal to L. So last day we have already expressed what is the difference between this L dash and L. So once again, let me show you the corresponding cross-sectional view. So you do have two different N plus regions like source and drain, and oxide layer is placed. And this is known to be the channel length, the total length of the channel, that is L. And if the pinch off occurs, and if the channel is pinched off over here because of a very high value of VDS, and then this length is known to be the L dash. And this is the point where V of L dash, I can write, this is equal to VGS minus VTH. So this L dash can be written as L minus some delta L, where delta L is this distance, where the channel is not existing. So L dash can be written as L minus delta L. And obviously you can understand that this delta L is a function of the drain to source voltage. So if I map it as a linear function to VDS or drain to source voltage, then the expression tells me ID is equal to half mu n C ox W upon L dash. So far we have VGS minus VTH whole square only. So L dash can be written as L into 1 minus delta L by L. So therefore, 1 upon L dash can be written like 1 upon L into 1 minus delta L by L. So 1 upon L, and we have 1 minus delta L by L whole to the power minus 1. Obviously, this delta L is much small as compared to the L. So therefore, this factor, delta L by L, is small. So we can just neglect the higher order terms, and we can approximate it to be 1 plus delta L by L only. Obviously, there will be the higher order terms, 1 minus x whole to the power minus 1. So 1 plus x square and so on. So I'm just neglecting the higher order terms, assuming that delta L is small with respect to L, and which is essentially the case. However, this delta L will depend upon the value of the drain to source voltage. And this delta L by L, the proportionate change in the channel length, is dependent upon the corresponding value of the drain to source voltage. So this delta L by L can be equated to some constant lambda with VDS. Because if VDS is more, as you can understand, if the drain to source voltage is more, then obviously the corresponding value of delta L will be more, and the channel will be pinched off earlier. And if VDS is small, then the delta L will be small, and the channel will be pinched off closer to the drain region. So delta L by L, as a first-hand approximation, one can write this equal to some constant lambda multiplied with VDS. Now, having considered this particular approximation that delta L by L is very small, so one can write the expression for ID as half mu n C ox. Now instead of writing W by L last, I will write like this: W by L VGS minus VTH whole square. So 1 upon L last is given by 1 upon L into 1 plus this. So 1 plus lambda VDS. And this entire phenomenon is known as the channel length modulation. This is known as channel length modulation, and which is very much prevalent for short channel devices. Channel length modulation. If the length of the channel is very small, very large, so in that case, I can safely neglect this delta L with respect to L. But if the value of L is not that large, then I cannot neglect delta L with respect to L. And obviously, I have to incorporate the additional term, which is known as 1 plus lambda PDS. Now, as long as I incorporate this particular term into my analysis, then you can understand that the expression for the drain current, even if in the saturation region, is no longer constant. Rather, it will vary linearly with the drain to source voltage. So once again, let me draw the ID VDS curve considering the channel length modulation. So there you'll find that VDS. So you have ID over here, that is the drain current. So in fact, that value is linear when VDS is very small. And so far, we have assumed that it was like a constant if I just neglect the channel length modulation. But if I consider the effect, there will be a non-zero slope like this. So this is for a particular VGS. Let us consider another second VGS. So suppose this is the constant. However, it will increase like this. So this is the saturation region. With channel length modulation. And which is very prominent for short channel devices. And nowadays, the length of the channel is made smaller and smaller as the time progresses. In fact, almost 10 years back, the typical channel length was in the order of a few micrometers, and now the typical channel length is in the order of few nanometers. So you understand that over 10 years or so, the channel length, the length of the channel, has been reduced by almost 1,000 times. So therefore, these short channel effects are very much important to consider whenever you would consider devices, MOS devices, with channel length as small as few nanometers. So these are the two important effects, as we have mentioned. One is known as the body effect or the backgate effect. So let me summarize once again. So the body effect or the backgate effect will occur whenever the source and the substrate or source and the body, they are not connected together. So if they are not connected together, then because of a non-zero VSB voltage, the threshold voltage will be larger than VTH0. So VTH0 is the threshold voltage whenever the source and the bulk, they are connected together. So under which case the threshold voltage will be VTH0. And if the source and the bulk, they are not connected together, if the bulk potential is negative for an NMOS, N-type of MOSFET, then the corresponding value of the threshold voltage will be larger than the VTH0. And you need to take care of this particular effect, and this is known as the body effect. So every time if you don't want to have a body effect into your design, then you have to make sure that the source and the bulk, they are connected together. And the second effect is known as the channel length modulation. So as you see that if the value of the drain to source voltage is increased to some extent, then the channel will be pinched off. And so far we have neglected the corresponding reduction in the channel. So in fact, the total length was L, and because of this pinch off phenomena, the channel length was equal to L dash. So far we have, if the length of the channel is large, we can safely neglect this difference, this delta L. But if the channel length is small, then we cannot neglect this one. And we can approximate this one by means of a linear relationship with respect to the drain to source voltage. And accordingly, if I want to take this channel length modulation into my account, then the corresponding drain current is no longer constant. Even if in the saturation region, it varies linearly with the value of the drain to source voltage, that is 1 plus lambda PDS. That is the second effect, or secondary effect. And there could have been the third effect, which is known as the subthreshold conduction. So far we have considered that even if the gate to source voltage is even if the gate to source voltage is less than VTH, there will be no current conduction. but you'll find that there could have been some amount of current, very small in magnitude, even if the value of the gate to source voltage is less than the threshold voltage. And that can be very serious whenever you are designing a bigger circuit, suppose a circuit for a memory, whenever you have a large number of MOS devices, and if the sub-threshold conduction cannot be controlled to some extent, then there could have been some power loss even if the MOS is off. So even if the MOS is off, even if the gate to source voltage for all the MOS devices is less than the threshold voltage, there also you'll find that a certain amount of current will be flowing, a sub-threshold current, and which varies exponentially with respect to the gate to source voltage. And you will find that because of this particular current, there will be certain power loss, and which is not at all desirable. And since we are now looking at devices which are power efficient and the hardware efficient as well, so obviously the sub-threshold conduction is not at all a desirable event, and obviously we will try to get rid of the sub-threshold conduction to some extent. So with this, I think we have discussed a little bit about the device physics, about the MOS and the current voltage characteristics. Now, so far we have modeled the device in MOS, and the corresponding potentials for the PMOS will be just the opposite, because you know, for PMOS devices, it will be constructed on N-type substrate, and the two regions, the source and the drain regions, they will be P plus type, and the gate to source voltage, it will be a negative. That means that if I consider the gate voltage, it should be negative, it is not at all positive, and the threshold voltage is also negative. So the polarity for the PMOS devices will be just the reverse as compared to the NMOS devices. But the other calculations, like the linear region or the saturation region, the calculations, so the calculations will be remaining the same even for the second order effects, like the sub-threshold conduction, and we have this channel length modulation, and apart from that we have this body effect. So these effects will be there for both for the NMOS as well as for the PMOS. However, if I consider the current carrying capability, you must appreciate that the current carrying capability for the NMOS is larger as compared to the PMOS, because if you just take a look at the expression for the current, the drain current, you'll see that it is given by half mu n Cox W by L VGS minus VTH whole square. So we can control VGS, we can accordingly fabricate the device so that the W by L can be selected as per our wish. Cox can also be modeled, but mu n, this mobility of the electrons cannot be changed, mobility of the holes cannot be changed. And you know, the mobility of the hole is small as compared to the mobility of the electron. Electron mobility is large as compared to the hole mobility. So therefore, even if all the parameters are same, same COX, same W by L, same VGS minus VTH, then if you have two different choices like NMOS or PMOS, which one to select, then obviously you will go for an NMOS device, because for NMOS device, the ID is proportional to mu n, and for PMOS device, ID is proportional to mu p. And since mu p is small as compared to mu n, so therefore, as far as the current carrying capability is concerned, the PMOS is not at all an advantageous one. The NMOS will be the desirable one. So with this, I think we have come to the end of this introductory lecture on this NMOS and PMOS devices. And hopefully from the next day, I'll be discussing about the circuits pertaining to the different types of MOS devices.